Добрый день, меня зовут Бруно Кота, я президент CCLR, Luso-Russian Chamber of Commerce and Industry, Dabro Pajalavat. It is my pleasure as a president of CCLR to welcome you to our webinar, Portugal, a Platform for Investment. Let me introduce you our honor guests, His Excellency Ambassador of Portuguese Republic in the Russian Federation, Mr. Paulo Viseu Pinheiro, His Excellency Ambassador of the Russian Federation in Portuguese Republic, Mr. Mikhail Kaminin, and partner of RFF Law Firm, Mr. Rogério Fernandes Ferreira. Before we start, I want to ask all the participants, please be sure you put your camera off and sound on mute. At the bottom of the screen, you can see a chat box. You may write there questions, and we will try to find time to answer some of them at the end. Many thanks. So it is my pleasure to invite His Excellency Ambassador Mr. Paulo Viseu Pinheiro. The floor is yours.
Thank you. Muito obrigado. Espero que me estejam a conseguir ouvir todos. Muito obrigado, Bruno Cota, Presidente da Câmara de Comércio Luso-Russa, Indústria. Tem dobre dien. Ochi priyatna, vidit vas. A etama webinar. I would like to start by greeting my good friend and colleague Mikhail Kaminin. We've done many things together in good and not so good times, such as these COVID times. Mikhail, you are the living proof that Russia and Portugal are trusted partners and friends in many fields, century-old partners, by the way. We will continue working together to seize the many opportunities that arise from a strong ties and commonalities that unite us and work to reduce those issues that still keeps us apart. Also, my heartfelt congratulations to my old colleague and friend, Rogério Fernandes Ferreira from RFF, who approached me first a few time ago on organizing this webinar. Congratulations as well to the CCLR, the Portuguese-Russian Chamber of Commerce and Industry, chaired by Mr. Bruno Cota, for co-organizing this webinar. I greet each and all of you participating this afternoon, wishing you above all health. Stay safe. We are living in COVID times, waiting for a vaccine, and looking forward to a return to a new normal life. It is too soon to say if a recovery will be in a V-shape, or a U-shape curve, or even a L. But with a vaccine, in view, I dare to say that it may be a V, it may be a U, it may be a L, depending on the economic sectors. In any curve or shape of the economic recovery, and I, as European, can only be proud that we have come together in the European Union with a very ambitious recovery plan and a multi-year budget, I trust that you will be betting right, investing and doing business with Portugal. The question is, why Portugal? Well, so many reasons. It is difficult to choose a criteria set. I will ask you to check ICEP, why Portugal, precisely, and ask you all to refer to our Economic, Commercial and Investment Department At the Portuguese Embassy in Moscow with Mr. Nuno Leite, Lima Leite, which is also attending this webinar and is here with me, or directly the ICEP headquarters in Lisbon. I will risk emphasize some criteria which might prove of interest in terms of investing and doing business in Portugal. I will start with the strategic location. All Portuguese navigators, all Portuguese navigators maps will put Portugal at the center of all every map, Mundi map, Mapa Mundi. Because it was the Atlantic, the North, South, the Mediterranean, Europe, Americas, Africas, and please note that I'm using the plural forms, markets of hundreds of millions consumers, and we have to add to the 500 million EU consumers, the CPLP market, for instance, the Portuguese-speaking countries community, or the equivalent of the Portuguese Commonwealth, with its vast market made of Brazil, Angola, Mozambique, Cape Verde, São Tomé, Guineas, the two Guineas, Bissau and Equatorial, and Timor in Asia. Look at the time zone. Portugal is 1 hour from the Central European time, same time as in London. And we are also the nearest European country to the United States and Canada. We have the euro as a currency. We are a founding member of the OECD. We are a stable democracy and a world champion on security. For an investor, it's important security. We are number three in Global Peace Index, number three worldwide. Next, I will choose the competitiveness and ventures criteria to choose Portugal to invest and do in business. Look at the talent. We are world top 15. We are number 13 in the skilled labor rank. Skilled labor rank. We are world number 7 at the language skills. World top 15 in management education. World number 18 in terms of university education, and world top 11 in graduate certificates. We have the second highest rate of graduate engineer certificates in Europe. And in science and maths, we are now above the OECD average. I will also point out to the innovation criteria. In European Innovation Scoreboard 2020, Portugal ranked number 12. In World Economic Forum, my country also scores well, and that may explain why firms such as Bosch, such as BMW, chose Portugal to locate its largest dedicated R&D centers, looking for not only mating in Portugal, but looking for inventing in Portugal. And what about infrastructure and connections criteria? Well, we have 4 international airports in mainland Portugal, besides Madeira and Azores, of course. We have 6 international seaports, and one, particularly Sines, is one of the biggest transshipment ports in the world. More than 3,000 kilometers of highways. We have the number 8 in the highways density in all the OECD, 2,562 kilometers of railroad network with the new and fast connections being foreseen, international flights connections to almost everywhere, many connections dedicated to Africa, to the Americas, once again in plural, Europe. And look at the diaspora, look at myself, I have Macaes in China and Goese origins. And in that sense, Portugal, as Russia, is truly an Euro-Asian. But also Portugal is Euro-African and Euro-American, with more than 5 million Portuguese and Portuguese descendants living abroad. The post-COVID world will probably be digital. And how does Portugal stand in this criterion? So first, we have to look at the telecommunications. Suffice to say that we are number 7 in AIB's digitalization index worldwide, and number 9 in digital public services, and number 11 in communication technology. We are a broadband country. It's difficult not to have Wi-Fi everywhere. We are planning and advancing fast in that. What about quality of life? Well, we have Mikhail Kaminin can speak that, about that quality of life in Portugal. For sure, he can also speak about it. But besides the security, the cost of living and the welcoming environment, Portugal, it's right now world number one in the best quality of life country for expats. It's an important criteria if you are investing in Portugal. I will leave for others, such as Rogério Ferreira, the attractive incentives by way of fiscality or the tax regimes, tax credits, tax exemptions in productive and about jobs and R&D or special tax regimes for expats. And Rogério will for sure will expand on these items, on these issues, much better than myself. All in all, and it's not by chance that Portugal ranks second most open country to foreign direct investment in the very strict OECD index. Let me repeat, the second most open country to foreign direct investment in the OECD ranking. I was ambassador in the OECD for a while, and I can assure you that these criteria are very, very tough to obtain. This helps to explain how so many big companies from around the world have chosen Portugal to their industrial investment. Just to mention a few examples in the new technology fields, I will mention Siemens, Bosch, Mercedes, Natixis, Schroeder, Cisco, Vestas, Volkswagen, BMW, Carlsberg, but also Google or Amazon Web Services. Besides this, Portugal is the host of the Web Summit since 2016, and we will continue to be the host. We will continue hosting the Web Summit at least till 2028. Last year's edition, as Ambassador Mikhail Kaminin knows better than anyone else, because he's also very active in the framework of the Web Summit. Last year, there were around 220 Russian tech companies in Lisbon attending the Web Summit. And I know that Bruno Cota and Ambassador Mikhail can also witness this as an important event between Portugal and Russia, being together in exploring opportunities and business. I will end by saying that our economy's fundamentals are strong. Many criteria, but I will pick some of them. The exports to the GDP, for instance. Unemployment rate, although now we are living the pandemic time, but the unemployment structural rate is low. The exports growth, and of course the capacity of attraction of foreign direct investment. So, as the music goes, I will say to our Russian friends and partners and investors, I will say, go west. Go west and be bold enough to link Vladivostok to Lisbon, as President Vladimir Putin keeps saying and reminding Europeans. I do trust that you will be interested and succeeding, investing and doing business in Portugal and Portuguese companies, and that we will find not only a very attractive and welcoming environment, a very also very interesting in terms of competitiveness. So, for all, once again, passiva vam, čas liva.
Thank you very much for your brilliant speech. Now it is my honor to invite His Excellency Ambassador Mr. Mikhail Kaminin. The sound is mute, so.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much, Excellency. Excellency, my dear friend and colleague, Paulo Pinheiro, Excellency, President of Chamber, all the participants, welcome. Мне очень приятно, что участвует и много представителей российской стороны. And first of all, I like to thank Lusa Russian Chamber of Commerce for the initiative to carry out this webinar, Portugal, a platform for invest. I fully agree with all reasons and arguments presented during the speech of my colleague. The life in Portugal is excellent. And also I can say welcome, welcome to Portugal. Our both country, Russia and Portugal, have a long-term positive experience of successful and friendship cooperation. Last year, we celebrated the 240th anniversary of diplomatic relationships. Our political dialogue is developing successfully. In December of 2018, in Lisbon, took place the seventh session of Joint Economic Commission. During that event was signed the roadmap for promoting the cooperation in the area of trade, economic, and investments for the period up to 2020. The roadmap serves as a practical implementation mechanism for our interaction in the area of investment. Obviously, the roadmap has to be updated because the impacts made by COVID on the bilateral business context is serious. In this connection, I would like to propose to continue our investment project dialogue in webinar format together with the Russian Direct Investment Fund, which is one of Lusa Russian Chamber members. And this fund also acting as a trigger for direct investments in Russia and also in Portugal. And I wish to webinar participants successful implementation of their plans. And once more, welcome to Portugal. Thank you for your attention.
Bruno, desculpa incomodar, estavas no mute.
Sorry. So I'm glad to invite Mr. Rogério Fernandes, the mentor of this initiative. So the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, first of all. I would like to thank to the Lusa Russian Chamber of Commerce and Industry for this initiative, that it's also yours. And a special thank, of course, to both ambassadors, Mr. Mikael Camini and Mr. Paulo Vizio Pinheiro. I'm sure that Mr. Ambassador, Russian Ambassador, will accept that I just give a word to my old colleague, Alvisio Pinheiro, that it's really a pleasure to see him face to face, because in fact we were together in the university, it makes more than 30 years. So it's really, really a pleasure to be here with you. So a special thank to both of you. A special thanks also for Mr. Bruno Valverde for the initiative. I will start with you, our presentation. I don't want to take you so much time. Our goal it's to speak a little about Portugal not only as a platform for investments, but also a platform for investments and residency. In fact, I think I can say that all the Portuguese governments from the left side and from the left wing and from the right wing took measures during the last, I would say, 14 years to attract foreigners to Portugal and to attract foreign investment to Portugal. As Mr. Paulo Viseu Pinheiro, our ambassador in Russia, have just said, in fact, there are some elders in Portugal that are there. We have a good climate, we have a historical heritage, we have a low cost of living compared with many other countries in Europe and in other places. We have very and wonderful landscapes, a good culinary, we have a safe environment and a low crime rate. I'm always saying to my clients that come to our offices that they can be at night in the center of Lisbon where we are at 4 o'clock at night without any problem at all. So we are, I think, maybe the third or the fourth safest country in the world. This is really, it gives really quality of life. So we have high quality education and a good public health system. And as Mr. Paulo Viseu Pinheiro just told, there is a ease of doing business in Portugal. As I was saying, the Portuguese government, since many years, left-wing and right-wing, are attracting foreign capital to Portugal. Maybe because, unfortunately, we have a huge public debt, but there are some elements that I must speak about and that are good items to know. In order to come to Portugal or to invest or to live. I would speak to you about some of them. We will speak a little about our different visas, starting by the Golden Visa, also about our specific tax non-dom regime, like the one you find in the UK or in Italy or in Greece, called the non-habitual tax residence regime. I will speak a little also about our regime in Madeira and about our participation exemption regime, and I will finish with some other items like the network of tax treaties signed by Portugal during the last, I would say, 25 years. And that I'm going to tell you that can cover today almost all the OECD countries with some exceptions. Meanwhile, the Portuguese government, and I would like to say that they are from the left side and the left wing and from the right wing, so this is a strategical and political issue, are taking all these kind of measures. Starting by the Golden Visa, that it's the most well-known. In fact, it's a Portuguese residency permit for investment activity. It's the, I would say that 85% of the real estate investment is 85% of the Golden Visa are for real estate investment. So the purpose of this Golden Visa is to obtain a residency permit in Portugal that allows to circulate in Portugal, but also in the Schengen space, so in all Europe, in all the world. So it's, I would say that it's a kind of European passport that allows a foreigner to circulate in Europe like if he had an European passport. For that, there is this golden visa is valid for one year period. It has to be renewed for two subsequent periods of 2 years. So the general conditions, the main general conditions are, and the first one is to keep the investment during a minimum period of 5 years. And I would say that there is a second one, which is a minimum stay in Portugal during the first year of 7 days, and during the second and the third, 14 days, and the third and the fourth and the fifth, also 14 days. The advantages. First of all, there is a possibility of family reunification. So it may include your wife or your husband, but also your kids. It will allow people to travel within the Schengen area, so including Switzerland, with a reduced minimum permanence period of 7 days per year, as I have just told you. The last is that after the fifth year, it's possible request a permanent residency and even the Portuguese citizenship, so a Portuguese passport. The investments, the eligible investments activities, as I have just told you, 85% is a real estate purchase, but there are many other alternatives that I left you there, including financial investment in financial assets and on other financial assets. And other capital investments or cultural investments, including job creation, 10 jobs in Portugal, or a mix of company and job creation. But nevertheless, there are some different visas, not so well known as the Golden Visa, like this one, the Passive Income Visa. Well, in fact, the advantage of this passive income visa is that you will not need an investment in Portugal. But at the same time, you will have to stay in Portugal more than 7 days per year. I would say that you will have to stay in Portugal more or less or kind of minimum of 4 months. This passive income visa, also called type 1 visa or D7 visa, is a two-step process that allows sub-country residents outside of the European Union to obtain also a residence permit in Portugal. And you can also here have the right and the possibility of family reunification. Well, the main condition is that is that you will have to prove to the Portuguese authorities that there is enough income to support their life in Portugal, and you have the sufficient means of subsistence to live in Portugal without depending on the Portuguese estate. But there are also another kind of visas called this one. It's the startup visa. The startup visa is also a resident visa for non-EU Schengen startup founders who want to establish their business and to reside in Portugal. Its aim is to attract investment, but also to attract talent and innovation in Portugal. And this startup visa, like the other two, also allows the family reunification. Just a note, a word about the Portuguese citizenship to Sephardic Jews. There is a decret law of 2015 that allows the descendants of Sephardic Jews apply for the Portuguese citizenship, of course, with correlative rights and obligation. There are some conditions here, being majority or being or having majority age or being emancipated under the Portuguese law, and also not having been convicted with for a crime or to a prison sentence of 3 years or more in accordance to the Portuguese law. Well, the non-habitual sex resident regime is a kind of non-dom tax regime, like the one you find in the UK, as I just told you. I would say in a lump sum that this tax regime allows you or someone who change of tax residency from other country to Portugal to be exempted of personal income tax of almost all the income coming from outside of Portugal. So it may include salaries, fees, capital income, including dividends, bank interests, or royalties, but also capital gains on immovable property or pensions. So the tax regime is different if the income is coming from outside of Portugal or is coming from an activity in Portugal. So there is a difference between foreign source income and Portuguese source income. Well, for the first source income, most type of income, so including employment, so salaries or fees or capital income or capital gains on immovable property, they are exempt from Portuguese personal income tax. If we are speaking about pension income, nowadays, and since March of 2020, there is a 10% flat rate on the patients coming from outside of the country. Of course, there are certain conditions to be verified related to the double tax treaty applicable on each case. On the contrary, the Portuguese source income will be taxed with a flat rate of 12% on salaries and on fees, on employment and self-employment income. For that, there is a list, a public list, with the activities called high value added activities that I would say that it's a large list that includes many activities that are included, in fact, in this list. So if you have an activity included in this list, it's possible to have a flat rate of 20% on fees and on salaries. This is important to know that we have progressive tax rates between 0% until 48% with surplus charges of 5%. So it can go from 0% until 53% of personal income tax rate. Just a word as well of the taxation on real estate. In fact, we have three taxes. A tax called the EMT, which is a municipal transactional tax, that goes from zero until 6.5, nowadays a little more, when you buy, you purchase real estate, an apartment in Lisbon or in Porto or in another city. This is on purchase. You also have a NIMI, also municipal tax, that is on the urban property between 0.3% and 0.45% on the VPT. The VPT is a kind of official value of the real estate, it's more or less, I would say, 85% of the market value. And nowadays, you also have what we call the IME, an additional tax on holding of the real estate, that is different for individuals and for companies. And for individuals, it's 0.7%, also on the VPT, as I told you, more or less 85% of the market value of the real estate. But in fact, this 0.7%, just tax values higher than 600,000 euros. And if you are married, just higher than the double, which means higher than 1,200,000. And as we are speaking about 85% of the market value, we can say that the 0.7% will tax only values higher than more or less 1,500,000 euros of VBT. Just a word as well to our International Business Center of Madeira, just to let you know that the corporate rate tax in Portugal is 21%. With some municipal, also some municipal taxes, but in Madeira, it's not 21%; it's 5% for companies in the free zone of Madeira that are incorporated until the end of this year. This regime of Madeira is authorized, is a state head, authorized, it's considered as a state head, but is a state head authorized by the European Commission. So we have this specific regime, I would say, not like this one, but different kinds of regimes, in this ultra-peripheric zone, and considered for European Commission as a ultra-peripheric region, including a tax treaty like that. So that's why the European Commission, this is the reason why the European Commission allows this tax situation. So in Madeira, with some conditions fulfilled, like job creation or investment, there is this possibility of a tax rate of 5% on profits until 2027. Just a word about other, just one other tax benefit, which is in fact this withholding tax exemption on the payments of dividends to foreign shareholders. So it's important to know that you will find in Madeira tax regime not only 5% on profits until December 2027, but on the expatriation of the dividends, there is no withholding tax to non-residents. Our participation exemption regime, it's interesting to know this specific participation exemption regime that exists in Portugal, because there are many foreign investors that don't know it. I'm thinking about Brazilian investors, namely. They usually come to Europe through the Netherlands, or even through Denmark or through other countries, because of the kind, because of this participation exemption regime, but without knowing that we have this participation exemption. This participation exemption regime, it's a kind of parallel situation of the other one for that we find for the non-habitual tax resident regime. In fact, if you incorporate a company in Portugal, and if this company holds a participation of 10, 20, 25, 100% of another company outside of Portugal, the dividends received in Portugal, as well as the capital gains on the selling of the participation in another company outside of Portugal, will be exempted of corporate tax. So this is important to know. And in fact, if we conjugate all these tax sellers, we understand why the Portuguese governments from the left, from the right wings, want to transform Portugal as not only as a destiny of investment, but also as a platform of investment, not only to Portugal or to Europe, but also to Africa, to Latin America, but also to Asia and to other East countries. Just a word as well for our SOCIMIs. This is the name, the Spanish name. This is real estate management companies, our rights. Just a word, because this is a very it's a new tax regime and the new situation of CG. This CG, they have a specific also specific tax regime. They are subject to the general corporate income tax, but the income from rental of real estate, from capital gains on property, from capital income, including dividends paid by the entities in which the CG has interest, are excluded from the calculation of the company's taxable profit. This CG, excluding these kind of profit, are subject to the general tax rate of 21%, but also exempted from the municipal and state surcharges. Just a word for the shareholders, for the investors. The withholding tax on dividends and taxation of capital gains on the sale of shares is as a rate of 28% for individuals that are considered tax residents in Portugal, 25% for corporate entities resident in Portugal, but 10% for non-resident investors. Well, and the last note about the double tax treaties that have been signed since more or less 25 years. As if you count them, they are 78 in force, in fact. This network of double tax treaties signed by Portugal with other countries cover all the Portuguese-speaking countries without any exception, including Angola, that was signed just some months ago. It also includes Russia, of course. It also includes Russia. And it includes all the European countries without any exception, and I hope that I'm not making a mistake, but it includes almost all the OECD countries, with the exception of Australia and New Zealand. So I think we can conclude as we started, Portugal as a destiny of investment and as a place to live. There are some errors, some tax errors, that we have to be aware and we would like you, investors, or people that would like to live in Portugal, to put Portugal on the map and think, when you think in Europe, or you think in Africa, or you think in Latin America, or even in Asia, think that Portugal is a platform of your investments, even if the destiny is another country or another place. Thank you very much for your patience, I'm at your disposal to clarify any question that you may have. Thank you.
So thanks a lot, Mr. Rogério, for your brief and but also detailed and efficient presentation. During your presentation, we were receiving questions both in chat and also via email. So of course, we won't be able to answer all of them, but we've chosen three questions. So if you allow me, the first question is connected with Golden Visa. So is it possible to purchase several properties, real estate properties, and to use the total amount of purchase to apply? So is it obligatory to buy one property, or you can buy several and sum the amount? Rogério?
The answer is you have a minimum of capital of investment, okay? So, if you are speaking about real estate investment,
yes,
we have a minimum in the most common situations of 500,000. You have also, as you just seen, other options of 350 in some situations you have less. But answering to this question, you can buy one, two, three, or four. The important thing is to make the investment of the minimum. Mm-hmm.
That is, okay. Thank you. That was exactly the question. So for Valentina, the first question is answered. Second question is connected with this adaptation to pandemia and the virus time. So now for investors, it's difficult to travel, to check the properties and to check the projects. So what is done in order to simplify for investors to visit or to analyze the projects or the properties?
In fact, and during the COVID period, that we are confined at home, almost everything was working by on the internet. So nowadays that things are changing, this is not really a problem. Things can take a little more time because we have to schedule sometimes meetings. It takes a little more time, but it's not really an issue, in my opinion. Everything or on the internet or
as agências imobiliárias fazem visitas virtuais.
The real estate brokers, mm-hmm. they can introduce by the internet to the investors some opportunities of investment also in Portugal. And at the same time, you have flights also to Portugal. Not every day, not as you had before, but you can fly to Portugal as well.
That's exactly what the question was, because now to Russia and from Russia, we don't have any direct flights, even no expectation flights. So what's your advice? Should investors wait until sometime in autumn the airspace will be open? Or it's better to book online meetings, online visits? What's your opinion?
Well, in my opinion, what they can do is, first of all, contact some real estate brokers or some promoters in order that they can check everything before coming to Portugal. They will not lose time. This is the first thing. And we can do also our work. So we buying by the internet, we can do almost everything, sending legal opinions, framework, tax frameworks, etc. We can do almost everything. So when they arrive to Portugal, they have the homework then, so they can start to.
Okay. Yes, surely. So thank you for this answer as well. Hello, Rogério.
Yes, please.
Good. And so one more question we received. What are the most profitable areas to invest in Portugal? Again, in your opinion, you know, so of course, there are lots of industries, lots of areas. So if you can give some examples of some projects or your personal opinion.
I'm not the right person for this answer, but the answer that maybe the person who is asking needs. I can just give you my opinion.
Exactly.
It's really an opinion. So I'm not a real estate broker, so I really don't know. I just give you my impression. So
yes.
If it was me, I will prefer to invest in the capital, I would say. Just because if I compare Lisbon to Paris, to Madrid, to London, maybe the prices in Lisbon will be maybe one third of Madrid, 1 to 5 to Paris, maybe 1 to 9 and 1 to 12 to London. So you have a gap of prices between Lisbon and other countries that can be interesting for foreign investors. Mm-hmm. At the same time, as you know, we have our airport is in the middle of Lisbon. So you are 5-10 minutes from everywhere.
Exactly.
It's an international airport. Mm-hmm. So you can invest in Lisbon and being in many other places very quickly. But I think that Mr. Nuno Lima Leite will explain this very well, much better than me. I'm quite sure. Okay.
Svetlana,
yes.
I was changing here a message with Nuno. So maybe Nuno could answer and say something about this.
Surely. We still have time. So let me pass the floor to Mr. Nuno Lima Leite, who is the representative of ICEP in Moscow in the Russian Federation. So if you please could add and answer more profoundly to this topic. Thank you, Nuno.
Hello. Hi, everybody. Are you hearing me?
Yes, perfect.
Yes, sound is good.
Good. So first of all, sorry, I'm not skipping to answer the question. But first of all, Mr. Rogério Ferreira, thank you very much for your presentation about our country to the Russian entrepreneurs. I also would like to enhance, as His Excellency the Ambassador of Portugal and Russia already had the opportunity to point out about the main reasons to choose Portugal. So I know that this seminar is very focused on the real estate and visas and the tech visa and golden visa, all of that, all the fiscal benefits of investing in Portugal. But if you allow me, I also like to point out a few of the advantage that, in my opinion, when I speak with Russian entrepreneurs, why they should choose Portugal. First of all, the strategic location, as Mr. Ambassador already spoke a little bit about that, as well as the platform to invest in all the Portuguese-speaking countries community. The second one that is many advantage, in my opinion, that is the talent of the Portuguese, the business and innovative environment, and the framework that Portugal has to offer to all the companies, the foreign companies that choose Portugal. As Svetlana already kindly said, my name is Nuno Leite. I'm the director of ICEP. ICEP is the governmental agency for the foreign investment and promotion of the external trade of Portugal. I am based in Russia. I'm based in Moscow. We have here an office at the Portuguese embassy. And I like to make very clear that all the Russian companies are more than welcome to contact us regarding sourcing and investing in Portugal. So, after this brief presentation, please, Svetlana, tell me again which was the question.
Yes, surely. So, what are the most profitable areas to invest in Portugal?
Yes, Tatiana, as Mr. Rogério, that is a lawyer, said very well, I'm an economist, I'm not a lawyer. But as he said very well, it's my personal opinion, right? So, me, I'm from Porto. For sure, I would say Porto is the best option to invest, is the city that is developed. But for sure, in Lisbon, there's much more demand and much more possibilities. So I think Portugal, and when I speak about Portugal, I speak about Madeira and Açores, it's all of them, all these, all Portugal presents great options for the Russian companies to invest. I have no doubts, after living in so many countries and passing for so many other offices around the world, and I see Portugal from abroad, from outside. And for what I see in the country that I live before, Portugal, for sure, it's a great opportunity for all the companies, foreign companies and foreign citizens to choose to live. Even you have that, I don't know if Mr. Rogério didn't speak about this, even you have that special program for retirement people that want to get retired in Portugal. That in some countries, it's that they are very famous. Like, that's why you have so many French retired people living in Portugal and Italian, you know. Also, that possibility is not direct investment, but it also involves the real estate, also involves developing our cities. So I cannot reply to you which is the best opportunity or where are the best better opportunities to invest. I'm not a broker, but I would say that any city in Portugal would be a great opportunity for investors.
Thank you very much, Nuno. And you just guessed exactly one more of the questions that we had here, because we had a question from Mariana, who was asking about the north. And you already talked that in the north, there are also good investment opportunities. So thank you for that.
And Svetlana, I'd like to add also, in Porto, in the north, you have a lot of developed. And if I have the opportunity, I must say that one of my biggest surprises since I came to Russia, I just started in the end of January in Russia. And I must share with all of you that the Portuguese wine in Russia is very famous. So it's difficult to find in other capitals, like I find here in Moscow, and not making publicity to some of the Russian retailers. But for example, in Globus, supermarket, you can find more than 60 reference of different Portuguese wine. This you cannot find in London, you cannot find in Paris, and here in Moscow you find 60 different reference of wine in just one retail store. I think this is amazing, you know. So starting
finally,
with the wine,
yes
starting with the wine, speaking about the construction materials, I think it's a huge market and with a lot of opportunities. Also to the Portuguese companies to come to invest in Russia, and of course the Russian companies go to invest in Portugal.
Exactly. Okay, so thank you very much. So first of all, dear keynote speakers, we want to express our attitude to His Excellency Ambassador of the Portuguese Republic in the Russian Federation, Mr. Paulo Viseu Pinheiro, and His Excellency Ambassador of the Russian Federation in the Portuguese Republic, Mr. Mikhail Kamenin, for your participation. So it was our honor to have you here with us today. Also, we would like to thank ICEP and Nuno Lima Leite for the participation and the addition and the help in the conclusion of the seminar. And of course, to the trade representative of the Russian Federation in Portugal, Mr. Sergei Baldin. Special thanks also to our technological partner, Kia, thanks to whom we are using this platform. And our great and special thanks to the RFF law firm and personally to Rogério Fernandes Ferreira and all his team for efficient preparation and the participation and the initial idea of having this kind of webinar. And of course, all the participants, we thank you for the participation and we hope that you had some useful information that you heard here today. For those who are not the members of SCC ILR, Because this webinar was open to all the partners and friends and clients. We would like to use this opportunity to invite you to join LUSE Russian Chamber of Commerce and Industry. So I, as a General Secretary, will be glad to answer any of your inquiries in the future. So once more, thank you everyone. Thank you our keynote speakers for the participation and all the participants from Russia, from Portugal. Thank you for finding time to be with us and in whatever you need. So now you know our contacts, you know RFF Law Firm. Now you even saw during video Nuno Lima Light. So even from that point of view, that's for sure was useful. So please feel free to contact us with further questions in whatever you may require. Thank you everyone and keep in touch for future events. Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.